Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, GDC. Are you excited? Yeah. All right. It feels like some of you have had coffee. Others are waiting to have your coffee. But this is good. I'll get going. I am the warm-up act for today. So you have two really good speakers coming after me. So if you can bear with me for about 5 to 6 minutes, I will get you in the mood and we will get going. So I should get to the next slide, yes. So we have a lot to talk about today. We're gonna talk about presence platform and specifically, you know, where we started, where we are today, what Quest 3 is showing us. I think all of us are excited about Quest 3, and we'll talk about, you know, what we are learning with Quest 3. And then all the cool stuff that we're building, many of which are actually available for you to experiment with today. And then lastly, the most important part of this, which is you, our developers, how are we thinking about the kinds of tools that hopefully we think you need to build some awesome stuff? So we have a packed agenda, and then we'll have some time for Q&A. So we'll get going. So to talk about our journey, it's actually easy for me to introduce myself so we can actually talk about the journey. So I'm Prabhu. I have a very long name. The easy way to remember me is call me Prabhu. I've been at Meta for about 5.5 years now. I started my journey in this company as the product manager for Oculus Quest 1. So I helped ship Quest 1. I immediately moved on to Quest 2. And after shipping Quest 2, I kind of said, hey, you know, I want to do something different. And here I am with Presence Platform. And this is important. And why is this important? Because I tell people my journey is actually very representative of how we are thinking about the evolution of XR, right? So early on, there was Rift. We all love our Rifts. And Rift was great. It offers incredible experiences. But Rift was tethered. There was a barrier of entry for a lot of users because you needed a gaming PC and you needed to be able to plug this headset in, you needed space to put your cameras. And so obviously we wanted to invent something that made it easy for you to just put on something and get into the magic of VR. That was Quest 1. So Quest 1 was great, but we also realized that we needed to be able to reduce the price and actually give more horsepower to this device. And thus was born Quest 2. Once we shipped Quest 2, we realized, you know, there are millions of users out there who are now enjoying the magic of VR. So my thought process was, okay, so we've given the devices, there are some awesome games for people to check out, what next? And this what next is what led me to get started with Presence Platform. So why Presence Platform? Why should it even exist? So with Presence Platform, our goal is to help developers think about what comes next. And the way we think about this is we are helping build the future of spatial computing. And with state-of-art AI, machine perception, graphics, and audio technologies, so you, our developers, can invent the future that blends the real and the virtual worlds. What does that really mean? I tossed a bunch of words out there. It means that you can create magic in living rooms and bedrooms and studies, wherever people are experiencing the magic of VR and XR. So we think about this next evolution in three big buckets. One, transformative mixed reality, right? Mixed reality is now the thing. We started thinking about mixed reality about 3 years ago. The very first thing we did with Presence Platform was ship a capability called pass-through. Pass-through allows you to wear a headset and see what's around you and have a sense of the environment. Once we shipped pass-through, we realized developers were starting to tinker with what was possible. And we were doing pass-through in, you know, grayscale 640 by 480 cameras, and people were still doing some incredible things. So we thought, hey, as we think about the evolution of our hardware, you have to also start thinking about the evolution of the algorithms, the software. So we started thinking about how can we make the room, the space around you magical. So we started shipping Scene API. Then we shipped Anchors, which allows you to pin stuff. And don't worry about it. Our other presenters are going to go into much more detail on this. So we started rounding out the magic of mixed reality. And now there are some really incredible experiences on the Quest 3 where you know, the room comes to life. There's no other way to think about it. We also started thinking about how do people want to show up in these kinds of experiences, right? So we want people to be whoever they want to be. Some of you might want to show up as a rabbit. There might be others who want to show up as a dinosaur. Some of you want to show up as a very cartoon-like version of yours. And some of you want to look exactly like you. So we have been chipping away at a whole bunch of technologies to make all of this possible over time, right? So we built body API, there is eye tracking, there's face tracking depending on the device, and then movement SDK, which allows you to start bringing much more realistic movement into experiences. And the last part about this, as you think about the connective tissue, is, you know, you can sense the space around you, you can move the way you want to move, you feel the way you want to feel, and you represent yourself the way you want to represent. Then the last thing about this is you want to interact the way you want to interact, right? So the way we think about that is today controllers are the primary means of people interacting in a headset. And controllers are great. They give you precision, they give you haptics, and we are very bullish in controllers. We've invested heavily on haptics because we think there's a lot of value there. But in the fullness of time, we think as more and more and more people want to get into experiences, that there will be a lot of them who want to just interact with your hands. Some of them might want to have a controller in one hand and have their free hand on the other. So our job is to build these technologies so you can imagine what to do with it. So you may build an experience that relies heavily on controllers. You may build an experience that needs no controllers, or you may build something that uses a controller in one hand and just your hand in the other, and our job is to make all of this possible. Ultimately, our job is to give you all these technologies so people, when they put on a headset, feel like they are in a place where they are comfortable, that they look the way they like to look, and they move and interact with the way they would like to. And this is the goal of Presence Platform. So Quest 3, so we launched Quest 3 last fall, and candidly, it's just been incredible. People have been doing their dishes. People have been mowing their lawns. People have been watching YouTube and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And trust me, we didn't plan for this. Our job was to give developers tools so, you know, people build great stuff. Along the way, we realized people are telling us how they want to use these headsets, which is just a joy to watch. I'm going to play a quick sizzle reel for Quest 3 because, you know, why not? I am going to figure out how to... That is the Quest 3. All of what you saw, or most of what you saw, are all games that you can enjoy today. And that's the magic of the device. I hope some of you, many of you, have tried a Quest 3. If not, you should totally try it. It's pretty incredible. I'm going to pass it off. I think one slide. There you go. Before I pass it off to Giray, just wanted to leave you all with this thought. What we are seeing with Quest 3 is some incredible momentum that, you know, this is an acceleration of what we saw with Quest 2, but you're also seeing a Cambrian explosion of a new kind of, hey, you know, what can I do with this device? Until we had Quest 2, people were building awesome games, and games are fun. This is the Game Developer Conference. I love games. I played Asgard's Wrath 2 yesterday. So, you know, we all like our games. But what we are seeing is there is so much more that people want to do, that developers want to build, that complements what you do just for fun. And this is the next era that I am super excited about, that Quest 3, that starting with Quest 3, we are hoping will grow into something big and huge, where your mother, your grandmother, your father, your uncle, your teenager, everybody has something to do in a headset and not everything is a game. So with that, I'm going to pass it on to Giray, who's going to dive into some of the capabilities that make this magic. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Prabhu. Right. Hi. My name is Giray. I'm a senior engineering manager and architect here on Presence Platform at Meta. Like many of you, I'm sure my fondest memories growing up were getting lost in the worlds of the games that I used to play. And the fact that a game that looked like this is Daggerfall, by the way, I think I'm dating myself. But anyway, the fact that a game that looked like this could transport me to a different universe was nothing short of magic to me. And I frequently wondered, you know, what would happen in the future when technology is no longer the gating factor for world building in games. Fast forward too many years. Fortunately for me at Meta, I found myself in the company of like-minded folks who really believed in the potential of gaming as a medium for storytelling and for bonding and for more. And together, we're building a platform, like Prabhu introduced, we're building a platform that gives you what I like to think is a vast set of tools to tinker with and build experiences that move this medium forward. So today I'm going to talk about a few capabilities that we provide at a high level. And kind of talk about how we envision them coming together and enable these new categories of gameplay experiences. I should be upfront though, like this is a brand new frontier. I won't claim we know exactly which combinations of capabilities and exactly which gameplay mechanics will resonate the most with gamers. But that's also what's enticing for me. I love to think that, you know, we are here to provide a canvas, point at a general direction where we think the treasure lies, and then, you know, go on this journey together with you. So, at a very high level, I like to talk about what sets Presence Platform games apart. Presence Platform gives you a unique ability to push the boundaries in roughly two areas, in our opinion. One is immersion, the other is adaptability. Immersion is basically the sense of presence, when you genuinely feel you are somewhere else and you're interacting with the world in the most intuitive way. And adaptability is the potential for gameplay mechanics that feel personalized and customizable for each player, which leads to emergent gameplay opportunities. I'll start with immersion. I mentioned in the beginning, even when I was playing Daggerfall at 320 by 240 resolution, I could almost feel like I was in Tamriel. Like I'm sure you all know the feeling, and that's what it is. As players, we really want to believe. Our brains are ready to suspend disbelief. It's almost like we make a pact. Our brains are like, okay, I'm gonna believe. Just give me something. Just give me some cues to make it easy. And Presence Platform on the immersion side provides these cues. Beyond the visual aspects, though, immersion is also engaging with the game in the most, you know, without the indirection distractions that might take you out of the experience. Like Prabhu mentioned, for some games, controllers are the perfect controlling input mechanism. But if you're King Kong swatting airplanes, you know, which one feels more visceral? Is it, you know, using controllers, or is it using your arms? Similarly, playing games seated, you know, is the right paradigm for most games. But, you know, if you're trying to get out of an escape room, which one feels more fun to walk around and actually interact with the room, or to point and click? That's kind of how we think about it in general. So we're basically trying to give you set of tools that makes the games feel immersive, unconstrained, and intuitive. All right, let's go more into specifics. It all starts with pass-through, which is a view into the physical world. When you overlay virtual content as is, though, it will feel out of place. It will not feel physically grounded. But as I mentioned, it doesn't take too many cues to, you know, too many perceptual cues to trick your brain that it, you know, you are there and establish those spatial relationships between virtual and physical objects. The most fundamental one probably is shadows. Even a, you know, blob shadow that's just a circle under the character, it makes a huge difference in how present virtual objects feel. And by projecting from virtual light sources onto the scene geometry, which I'll talk about in a second, we are able to render dynamic shadows on top of pass-through, which is on top of the physical world. The difference in perception of immersion is, to me, night and day. This algorithm is now in a new toolkit we release. It's called MR Utility Kit. Mike will talk about it after me, but the idea is that through MR Utility Kit, we make it super easy to incorporate this algorithm and similar capabilities into your game. If I had to come up with a top five list of immersion breakers, I think occlusions, or like being able to see a character behind a virtual object would behind a physical object would probably be like number one. And to fix this, we released Depth API with Quest 3. With Depth API, it is very easy to get dynamic occlusions working. And to go one step further, you can also bring in the room geometry.
The beauty of it is you can also bring in the semantic information we provide about the room to make the combined dynamic and static occlusions to have even higher quality occlusions in the end. But an important point is we don't only provide occlusions out of the box, which we do, but we also give you a raw per eye dynamic depth buffer that you can sample in materials. The idea here is that you can use Depth API potentially for other purposes. You know, you can use it for a depth-based fog, or maybe you don't want to occlude and you just like here, you want to show the outline, and you can do that. You know, you can build that logic in your materials again, or you can also make performance versus quality decisions. You might want to downsample or sample more, apply a filter. All of this is possible. This is a good example of how we approach APIs in general. We want to make the most common use case automatic, out of the box, but also give you the underlying data, underlying tooling to customize it for your needs and maybe even do things that we didn't think about. Another important cue that establishes a sense of presence is visual consistency between physical and virtual content. If there are fireworks in your game and your physical world, like the walls, are not lighting up correctly, it will not feel right. And to fix this, to help you maintain that consistency, we released pass-through relighting, again, with MR Utility Kit. It works similar to pass-through shadows that we just talked about. We project lights over the scene geometry and into a material, and then we overlaid over pass-through. MR Utility Kit makes it easy to bring in and customize it to your needs, again, just like we talked about for depth. So pass-through is essentially a camera feed brought into your game. So if your game takes place underwater, or if it's a, you know, cyberpunk shooter, it's almost guaranteed that the environment will not match. Almost. But with pass-through lookup tables, we make it super easy to bring the visual language of your game into the physical world. So it's as easy as taking a screenshot, applying the filter that you need in your favorite image processing program, and then feed it back into the app to create the look that you want. There are a few more, we can go very deep here. There are a few more tips, especially when you start talking about the scene mesh and how you blend that in. There's a lot more to talk about there, but I'm gonna actually recommend checking out another talk we have today. It's called Your Room is the Level at 1:20 p.m. today. Highly recommend checking it out if you're interested in this type of work. Now, on to the importance of audio for presence. I have a go-to anecdote about this topic. I was, years ago in the PS3 era, I was working on FPS, and we would do these focus tests. We would bring in players, and we asked them to play the game and rate the game on, like, graphics and gameplay, etc. Between two gameplay sessions, our graphics scores surged, and this didn't make any sense because we had absolutely zero changes in the visuals. Then we realized we actually changed the audio. We made a big audio quality pass, and since then, basically, the joke is I'm really convinced that good audio makes your game look better. And this only makes sense. Our brains are incredibly adept at detecting where an audio source is. We subconsciously measure the latency between when audio arrives in our left ear versus right ear, how loud it is in left or right, etc. We use all of this data to pinpoint where an audio source is with remarkable accuracy. And this is like supernatural for us. But the problem is most audio spatializers in game engines, they are built for mainly games on a screen. So I see many developers thinking they have spatial audio because they click the 3D audio button. And in most cases, this simply provides a left to right separation, and you don't really get the presence of like front and back, above and below, the same way you would do with a VR MR native spatializer. And that's what we provide in our audio SDK. It is purpose-built, and it will make and it renders audio that sounds correct in VR and MR. There is another aspect of audio that is crucial for immersion, and that is room acoustics. If your level takes place in a cathedral, but your audio sounds like you're in a basement, it will, again, another immersion breaker. That's a theme here. I think of this as almost like shadows and occlusions, but for audio. And like shadows and occlusions, good room acoustics physically grounds the experience. Within our acoustics SDK, we provide a robust shoebox reverberator that works for most environments. But this is also an area where we see a lot of opportunities, and in long term, we want to bring in solutions that take the whole room geometry into account and more importantly, almost do it within a reasonable compute budget. All right, we talked about choosing the right interaction model for your game, and inside-out body tracking is a great example of giving you more tools to choose from, just like Prabhu mentioned. It uses the HMD cameras, and it provides accurate tracking for elbows, wrists, and torso. This is super useful in some genres, like fitness or rhythm games, where the full body interaction is the game, basically. But also, better tracking, it has enormous power in social presence. It makes it, obviously more natural and expressive. So we see many opportunities in improving social presence in games through this capability. To get a glimpse of what it's like, we built a game, and I really invite you to try it out. So it's called Dodge Arcade on App Lab, and let us know. Let us know what you think. Avatars, switching to avatars, they are notoriously difficult to pull off when it comes to immersion and believability. And after all, it makes sense. Like, throughout evolution, most of our training data has been other humans. So we are very good at, again, to notice imperfections when something is not quite right. So if the tracking is not perfect, we historically, we would either not render that limb or reduce fidelity so that the expectations are lower from the player's perspective. But lately we made a ton of progress in predicting full body poses, and we feel confident that we can drive complex and realistic full body animations with it. A huge portion of this is legs, I'm sure you heard about it. Legs are a challenging problem to solve, and most solutions you would have to have external tracking, which is too much friction for gamers and most games, obviously. So instead, we came up with an approach that is, you know, what we call it generative legs. It basically uses the upper body information to predict using AI, you know, the leg poses, and it works well in majority of situations. There are limitations. You know, we only have the information about the upper body, so there are some movements such as lifting one leg that you won't be able to predict, and you should keep in mind as a constraint when you use this feature. To learn more about how to work with body tracking, at 3 p.m. today, we have a movement SDK session, and I recommend checking it out. We've had great hand tracking capabilities in Prism's platform for a long time. But to give you even more flexibility in how you embed natural interactions in your game, we recently released multimodal hand tracking. With multimodal, you can enjoy the benefits of both worlds, basically. Use hands for immersion and use controllers for haptics and precision. So, you know, you can, like, one example is on one hand you can be holding a weapon, and the other hand you can be casting a spell. So it opens, like, a lot more opportunities in that sense. Or you can also use hands and controllers interchangeably for comfort. And we particularly paid attention to how smooth that transition between controllers and hands as an input model is, so that you can make it as smooth as possible for for gamers. Okay, that was a recap of some of the features that we have, some of the capabilities that we have to provide incredibly immersive experiences. Next, I want to talk about how Prism's platform capabilities can enable gameplay mechanics that are, frankly, not previously possible. So, with Prism's platform, each player can get a unique and personalized experience. When the physical world is part of the level, even the simplest gameplay, like think of something like Pong, can be reinterpreted in numerous ways by the player directly. We think this is particularly appealing for sandbox-style gameplay. It's as if, you know, you're giving the player a level editor that they can customize the game with by, you know, rearranging things in their room or on their table. We are seeing the first examples of adaptive MR games like Demeter as well, and Laser Dance. We can't wait to see what the developer community creates takes this genre next. There's a flip side, though. Designing adaptive gameplay for the physical world has really unique challenges. How do you design a game when you don't know the level beforehand? And we think hard about this problem in Prism's platform, and we provide you tools to make it easy. Let's dive into a few of these features. So from day one, our philosophy has been to bring the physical world data to you in a way that feels, using the paradigms that you're already familiar with, working with virtual-only content. A great example is scene model. Scene model is automatically generated during space setup that every player goes through, and it contains the semantic and geometric information about the environment. And our North Star for scene model is to establish it as a singular scene graph for virtual and physical content, physical objects, so that you can program logic against them holistically. Currently, scene model contains a watertight mesh of the room, for the whole room, and it's best suited for physics and navigation use cases. It also contains labels and bounding boxes for the furniture in the room, and you can treat basically these objects as you would any game object and build your logic against them. I mentioned there are unique challenges building for an environment that you don't know. For example, say you want to spawn an NPC on a flat surface towards the center of the room where the player can walk to and, you know, where another NPC can navigate to. Normally, this is a lot of cascading logic that you have to write, and it only, you know, gets more complicated from there. So for this reason, facilitating MR content curation is a major priority for us. We recently released a set of content placement helpers in MR Utility Kit. But we think there is a lot more to do in this area, and we are looking into a variety of solutions, including AI-based ones. Surprise, surprise, I guess. Another challenge, though, in content creation for adaptive MR is having confidence that it will work in every environment, in every player's room and home. And for this, we released Meta XR Simulator. It can do other things, but this is one major use case, which is another tool that Mike will cover in a minute. Next is a problem I didn't appreciate until I started working in MR. So when building a game with virtual-only content, it's trivial that you have a global coordinate system that you can rely on and you can use. But once you bring in physical content, it gets complicated. It's expected that they will not mash, they will not stay in sync. How they drift, how much they drift depends on a few factors, but the bottom line is they will not match. We should not expect that they will match constantly. Traditionally, we use spatial anchors to create world lock content. The anchors track the reference points in the physical world and keep it world locked. But this mitigates the issue somewhat, but does not actually give you a single coordinate system that you can just basically forget about. With automated world locking, which is again part of Mixed Reality Utility Kit, we utilize the scene model that we just talked about. We utilize the anchors that back the scene model, and we automatically move the camera to keep the world, the virtual and physical world aligned, and preserve essentially a world lock coordinate system. So we solve this for you so that you can focus on iterating on the adaptive gameplay aspects as opposed to handling this complex problem and making things work. There is yet another dimension we haven't covered when it comes to games that adapt to environment, and that is multiplayer. Whether it's a shooter where you use furniture as cover, or whether an escape room where you're trying to, where you're collaborating with your friends to get out, mixed reality offers a ton of untapped potential in this area. Here, we have similar challenges to the world locking problem that we just talked about. How do you have a shared coordinate system? How do you have an aligned coordinate system between two players so that you can build logic that works correctly between them? Last year, we released shared spatial anchors to make this possible. And recently, Presence Platform's building blocks made it significantly easier. Again, Mike will talk about this. Mike, I'm doing a lot of marketing for you. We also have a few reference apps called Discover and Cryptic Cabinet, where we basically show you best practices and hopefully inspire you on what is possible, and then you take it from there. The idea is, again, we want to remove the technical complexity wherever possible so that you can focus on finding the fun and creating the best possible experiences that, you know, in the intro I talked about, you know, how experiences that can move this medium forward, basically. I'll now pass it to Mike to share more on how you can get started and quickly build immersive and robust and engaging XR games. Thank you.
All right, good morning. Are you guys excited to learn how to build for Mixed Reality Presence Platform and all the cool stuff we heard already? Yes? Amazing. My name is Mike. I want to start by talking a little bit about my first time trying a VR headset and having this amazing moment that the technology was good enough to really feel immersed into your environment. That was almost 10 years ago. That was Oculus Rift Decay 2. And the devices have gone a massive, massive way from there. We've seen them evolve to do all sorts of amazing, packed with amazing technology, mixed reality present platform. I think Giray gave an amazing intro to that. And I think with Meta Quest 3 and present platform, what you see is developers creating these wow moments for a new generation of gamers, a new generation of users coming to use these devices. And what I want to talk to you about today is how do you build with presence platform to create these new type of experiences that are enabled by Quest 3. Now, I've been chatting with some of you, and I know what some of you are thinking, right? How do I find the fun with mixed reality? How do I build something that takes the unique characteristics that we talked about today and make a fun experience out of it? So to showcase how to go from your first idea to your first prototype very fast, we tasked our team to create something from scratch in one afternoon. And what I'm going to do today is show you what they built, all done in an afternoon, combining multiple presence platform capabilities. And then we're going to talk about the tools that they use, the process, and how you can do that easily today. It's a very simple experience, but at the same time, you can see all sorts of different technologies that are being used. And again, this is all doable in an afternoon. Things got a bit heated there. Right, the first thing that you probably have to solve when you start building for XR is how do you set up? How do you set up your project in Unity or Unreal? How do you not waste time going through configurations, documentation, but get started building very fast? So that's why we built the project setup tool for both Unity and Unreal. Can I see a show of hands if anyone has used this before? A few hands, excellent. So we can go deeper into it and just describe the powerful simplicity behind project setup tool. The setup tool contains a large set of automatic fixes for your project. It will alert you if any issues require fixing and how to fix them with just one click. This is part of the Meta XR all-in-one SDK available at the Unity Store and the Meta XR plugin for Unreal. Now, here is how it works. After you install the latest Meta XR all-in-one SDK or the plugin for Unreal, you can open the tools menu from the bottom right toolbar in the Unity editor and select Project Setup Tool. There, you will see a list of all outstanding issues and recommendations, and you can just press fix all or select the ones that you want to fix individually. It's that simple. Some of these things can take hours just to figure out which configuration is not set up properly, but with Project Setup Tool, you can very quickly fix all that. So we brought Project Setup Tool to Unreal earlier this year, and we see a lot of developers using it. So if you're an Unreal developer, please try it out and let us know what you think. As I've already mentioned, it's a one-click fix configuration for all of the items of your project. It includes different types of issues, and all checks are done on the background, and you get a notification if something is not worked properly and needs fixing. Now, we have multiple levels of rules, from required to optional, and again, for any required rules that require fixing, you will see a notification. How does that sound? Does it sound good? Excellent. We can continue with the next tool called Building Blocks for Unity. This tool can help you easily discover and build a project with different presence platform features. You will see some familiar features that we've already talked about, and how it works, it's actually pretty easy. Once you've installed the Meta XR all-in-one package from the Unity Asset Store, you can open Building Blocks from the window that you just saw for Project Setup Tool. There, you can browse and select different blocks that you would like to add to your project. And the only thing that you have to do is drag and drop it into your scene. That's it. You're ready to go. Everything is configured for you on the background, and you can include in your scene multiple building blocks combining different capabilities. So, for example, if we want to build a mixed reality game like the one we saw earlier, with pass-through, room model, and hat tracking, all you have to do is drag these blocks into your scene. Now, what happens after you install a block is automatically all other blocks that are dependencies are installed for you on the background, and any required configuration is done automatically. Building blocks are equally suited for when you're trying to find the fan. So if you want to do some rapid prototyping with some of the features that we talked about today, or if you want a robust starting point for your development journey for your main project, building blocks are great for both. And you're free to customize one once you drag it into your scene. It's a Unity prefab. You're free to customize it as you see fit. Then you can tweak it as much as it fits your project, as it fits your creative idea. It's a very, very easy way to get you started. We went through a few of the core building blocks like hand tracking, pass-through, spatial anchors, and interactions and gestures. And we're excited to bring some new building blocks later this year on things that we know are more difficult or more complicated to pull together, and some of the newer features shipping with Presence Platform today, like Room Mesh. We're also going to introduce a set of building blocks around multiplayer use cases, collocation, avatars, multiplayer. We want to make it as easy as drag and drop a building block into a scene, so you can quickly prototype if some of these concepts make sense. All right, you can find it on V62. Actually, it's launched since V57 onwards. It's part of the Meta XR all-in-one SDK for Unity. And you can get building very, very fast with building blocks. The next thing I'm going to quickly talk about is the Mixed Reality Utility Kit. Giray mentioned it already a few times, but it's one of those sets of tools that once you go deeper into building with mixed reality, it can save you hours or not days by bringing you helpers to mix the virtual world with the physical world of the user. We know that can be challenging, that mix of physical and digital. I'm sure once you go deeper into mixed reality, you'll have questions like, where should you place content if you don't know the user space, right? Or how will the app look in different spaces? That was the motivation behind creating Mixed Reality Utility Kit in the first place. And here are some of the interfaces to perform some sim-related queries. You can see raycasting to anchors, checking reachability, positioning relationships of anchors, and spawning locations. For example, if I want to create a mixed reality tabletop game, it helps answer content placement questions like, where is the closest point of this desk in relation to my position? And how do I spawn content where it makes the most sense? It's pretty cool, right? Some utilities help with art styling of your app. For example, if you wonder, how can I reskin my walls without the textures looking too stretched? Or how can I make a desk model scale and match the physical desk nicely? The effect mesh helper in Mixed Reality Kit can also help render the walls so that the textures wrap around them smoothly without any seams and don't get stretched and deformed depending on their size. This is very crucial when you're reskinning mixed reality worlds. And one other really, really cool accelerator that is part of Mixed Reality Utility Kit is the debugger prefabs that allow you to inspect your scene data. Spawner tools make it easy to place virtual objects or furniture and replace the physical counterparts with various options to match orientation, size, and aspect ratio. So that's Mixed Reality Utility Kit, also available as part of the all-in-one SDK. Last tool I wanted to quickly talk about today is Meta XR Simulator. I know when you're developing for an XR device, putting it on and off all the time can be very tiresome. I see some nods, so I'm glad you guys are resonating with this. And it can really affect the iteration speed, right? It can make you uncomfortable and it can slow you down. So that was the motivation why we built Meta XR Simulator, where you can easily test and improve the mechanics, design, and overall user experience of your apps without putting the headset on. It's a fully featured OpenXR runtime that runs on your computer. It simulates the MetaQuest headsets with a lot of awesome features to help your development. We're gonna go through a few of them, but if you have a chance, do try and let us know what you think. Now, it's not a replacement for the physical device. You still need a MetaQuest headset to test real interaction experiences, graphics, and performance. but we're aiming that you will need to put on the headset less and less, mostly for fit and finish work, rather than the early setup phase of a project. Let's go quickly through some of the features. So we started building the one of the most important testing scenarios, interactions, inputs that you can use, match the headset like controllers or hands, and can be simulated with mouse and keyboard or an Xbox controller. The next thing we developed was mixed reality specific features. So we have the synthetic environment server where you can load synthetic maps that simulate a room's pass-through, scene, and angle information. These maps are captured and rendered in a photorealistic way so that you can be immersed in a realistic environment when you're iterating, again, without putting the headset on. You will be able to load your own rooms into the tool and customize the environment. It's a very cool feature. We're going to show a video of it in a little bit. But one other thing I want to talk about is the fact that you can open multiple instances of this tool with their individual OpenXR runtime, which makes it all on a single machine, right? Which makes it so easy to test multiplayer content. So for pass-through, you will see we support common use cases like background pass-through or pass-through windows. Here is one of the synthetic rooms. And I want to highlight that you can also choose the device you want to simulate. This is one of the environments. And I talked to you about four tools today, right? Project setup tool, building blocks, mixed reality utility kit, and Meta XR simulator. Let's go back to that chess example, collocated chess example, to see how it all comes together and how you can actually build this extremely fast. It looks funny when you're not in the headset, but here we go. Collocated MR chess game. This is the view from one of the headsets. And as we went through, we started with project setup tool to make sure that your project is set up for MR. You can click the meta icon on the bottom right corner. You will see some outstanding issues. You click fix all, and they're fixed automatically for you. It's as simple as that. You can go back as you're creating an experience like this one and check if more issues come and how to fix them very, very easily. We talked about building blocks, right? How do you take specific features and apply them into your scene, into your game objects? It's extremely simple, as you will see. We select some of the building blocks that make sense for the gameplay here and the experience that we are trying to design, drop them into the scene, and that's pretty much it. You can see the grab interaction block being applied to the game objects around the chess game. Now, MetaXR Simulator. So if you want to see what you've actually built, you just click the play button after you set up MetaXR Simulator, and you will see your chess game into this synthetic environment. It's pretty cool. The other feature that I talked about was record and play in multiple synthetic environments. So you can actually record an environment, load it on MetaXR Simulator, and see how your scene looks there. Last but not least, soon we'll be bringing building blocks for multiplayer. So the idea here is you can very, very easily drag a block around collocation into your scene. You can select the underlying integration that you would like to use. So we've already supporting Photon and Unity NGO. And you simply drag and drop it into your scene, and we take the rest, we take everything working on the background, basically. This is how it looks. And what's pretty cool is that we have the same experience in our booth for on Wednesday and Thursday. So drop by if you want to try to build this for yourself, or if you want to see how these tools can help more for your development. We're going to wrap up very soon. But before we leave you and before we open for Q&A questions, I just want to recap some of the things that we talked about today. many of the present platform capabilities that you saw are available for you to experiment, to see which of them fit your ideas. And a great starting point for these are some of the tools. So building blocks, project setup tool, XR simulator, mixed reality utility kit are all part of the all-in-one SDK for Unity. Setup tool is available for Unreal as well. And other meta tools that can help you in your development journey is the Haptic Studio and the Haptics SDK, and of course the Developer Hub, which is a great tool throughout your development process. If you're using one thing I want to highlight, if you know how to use AR Foundation, Unity's framework, we're also supporting some of the present platform features there, and we're bringing more in the next months, and supporting both Unity and Unreal. That's all from us today. Thank you so much for coming. Don't forget to drop by the booth later today. Thank you. I think we still have some time for questions.
We have 10 minutes for questions. And if you have more, we can always talk about later. Yep.
We'd also love to hear your feedback about the session. Do scan the code and let us know what you would like to see next year.
Hello. Right. Thank you for the presentation. I work on OpenXR and the Open3D engine, and I wonder how much of the presence platform is exposed through OpenXR, and how much of that is also available in, you know, C++ libraries, header files that I can integrate into another engine that is not Unity or Unreal.
So the question was about OpenXR and how much of those presence platform features are available for OpenXR.
You can take it. Actually, hang on. Make sure. It works. Okay. We pretty much build everything in OpenXR. So internally, we call OpenXR as our native library, which means that everything we build is exposed through OpenXR, Unity, and Unreal. So you should have, in theory, access to everything.
Hello. So I messed with the Meta XR audio SDK, and I agree, spatialized audio makes games look better. Is it designed to work with all platforms? Because as most developers are trying to build for multiple platforms,
By platform, do you mean
like Apple Vision Pro?
Different hardwares.
Yeah, hardwares. Yeah, that's right.
Do you want to take that?
Yeah. Right now, our priority is get stuff running on Quest, and that's kind of where we are right now. As things evolve, as we see opportunities, we would love to build on other platforms.
Okay, so it's not like you're trying to keep it only for Meta.
So. Yeah, right now, I mean, there is so much we want to build to make sure the Quest experience is great.
Yeah.
We just want to get past that, and once we're there, I think it'll be a great point to think about, hey, you know, is there more to be done here, or should we go to other platforms? And that's something that we will think about that time.
Yeah. Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. This is kind of in line with these previous questions, but what is like the commitment to bringing this to like PC-driven applications? He brought up OpenXR just in general. Like, what level of things do you guys want to prioritize in bringing across to OpenXR on a PC-driven application using something like AirLink?
Yep. So. PC is an interesting workflow. There are two types of PC users, as we've seen it. So some of our PC users are developers. So we are 100% committed to making sure that developers have all the tools they need. So between Link and AirLink, we expose all our capabilities so you can build everything on a PC and test it via Link or AirLink. Now, when you think about the user workflows, if you have a user on PC VR, it's a feature-by-feature trade-off discussion that we have. The reality is most of our users are on Quest all-in-one headsets. And as a result, the amount of investment it takes to build and bring features to PC VR is disproportionately high compared to the return. That said, we are actively exploring if this is an area, because we think in the future, as productivity use cases start taking off, that there will be a large number of users who use their PCs to consume some of this content. So we're definitely thinking about it, and we're actually actively exploring some of these.
Okay. Is there an opportunity to just get more detailed in questions? Like, when would the best time? You said the booth or, like, right?
We can talk about it outside or at the booth. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks for sharing. So we already built the VR game in the past. So for this Princess platform, our team focuses more on like how we can make use of the Princess platform. So my question is more about like app, like publishing, because previously our previous game, even we have almost like 300K total downloads across Pico and Quest, but it still have a problem for us, especially for a global developer to publish on the Meta store. So what about, how do you guys have any suggestion, for example, for the Princess platform, mixed reality app or games can have the better chance to be promoted or be chosen from the, by the Meta store? Any measurements or any like, yeah, insight?
Unfortunately,
from you guys?
I don't have any shortcuts for you. The store has its own policy.
Yeah.
What we typically do is, we think there's a great opportunity to build with Presence platform today. Mm-hmm. Many of our developers ship to App Lab. And then they find out that there's a significant amount of interest, and the store has its own policy when apps from App Lab get migrated to the store. We don't necessarily influence it ourselves. Our job is to make sure that you all can build great stuff, and a lot of users will try it out.
Okay.
That will give the store the right signal for them to pull it out.
Gotcha. Thanks.
Yep. Hello.
All right.
So I had previously used your building blocks, and it was an amazing tool that I used to build an animal control simulator, and it was amazing. However, I saw that all your examples were in Unity. Is there not a building blocks for Unreal quite yet? And if not, when is it planned to come?
Excellent question. Let's talk about it a bit later. Would love to understand how it makes sense to bring this concept to Unreal. We start with Unity because we know a lot of developers are there that they're experimenting with, and it's great to hear that you've already tried it. I would love to hear your feedback more in depth on Unreal and building blocks.
All right, and a final question for me is, I've been developing in Unreal for this past month with the Meta, and the plugin seems to have some issues with OpenXR, specifically in the pass-through area, where if you activate OpenXR, pass-through just does not function. Are you aware of this issue?
Can we talk about this outside?
Yes.
I would love to learn more. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. You mentioned that you have some kind of support for nerfs for the simulator. Is that something that's actually available?
Some kind? Sorry, I didn't hear that.
Support for nerfs?
Yes. So some of it is available today, some of it is coming in later versions. What exactly are you trying to do?
I mean, I'm thinking about actually scanning an environment, my own environment for testing or
I mean,
is this something that's available for us?
Not right now. So as a developer, what you can do is, as you're testing your app, what you can do is you can scan your surface, scan your room, and then bring it into your title and then test it out.
But not as a synthetic.
Correct.
Yeah.
That does not exist today.
All right.
Thank you.
Will it?
As in, not in the tool chain that we are offering today.
Okay.
We are obviously, nerfs is an area. I mean, you know, Meta is deep into AI. We've done a lot of research in nerfs, so we've actually shared a bunch of tool sets there. We, within VR and Presence platform, are actively looking at it. We don't have something that we can share today, but.
Okay.
Thank you. We'll take one more question, and I am happy to take as many questions as you have outside.
Hi. I wanted to ask about the performance when utilizing the features that you guys discussed with the Presence platform. Often I find it difficult I've never developed for mixed reality, but often I find it difficult to optimize the experiences that I build onto a headset for the hardware that the headset has. So I wanted to ask if you could share about any performance observations or metrics that you saw when implementing apps that utilize the Presence platform.
I think there's a talk that we can. I don't know when exactly. There's a performance talk.
We should. There is a performance talk at GDC. We would love to point you to that.
Okay.
We've written blog posts about this. We have good documentation around how to optimize for performance. And as you can imagine, a constrained headset, a mobile CPU, when you try to put on a lot of features, can be challenging. But again, if you've tried a Quest before, a Quest 3 before, there are tons of experiences that are just, you know, very performant, and they're able to do that because there are some best practices. We are sharing some of those at GDC. We'll share the time.
3:50 today.
3:50 today.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. Thanks.
We will take all questions outside. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you.